Briefly go over the abstract, just so we can ground ourselves. We're going to answer deep questions about the health of catalog runs on your nodes with Elasticsearch, Logstash, and Kibana. We'll be answering questions about resources, catalogs, runtimes, using Elasticsearch, Logstash, Kibana. These kinds of things can also be answered with Puppet Enterprise, Puppet Dashboard. Maybe the way we ask the questions and the data we have to answer these questions might be a little bit different. Things Elasticsearch gives us is full text search and filtering. We can perform metrics and aggregations on resources and runtimes, and we can visualize these in Kibana. So I'm Alex Elman. I'm a DevOps engineer at indeed.com. Connor Kelly is a colleague of mine. He was an immense help in preparing this talk for me, as well as my team back in Austin. Gave a few run-throughs, and they gave me a lot of great feedback. And I'd also like to thank Puppet Labs for inviting me to give this talk and share what we've been working on at Indeed. I help people get jobs. Indeed.com is the world's largest search engine for jobs. We write software that crawl the web and aggregate jobs. We concentrate those jobs in one place so that job seekers can search and apply for jobs easier than ever before. 180 million unique visitors in 55 countries in 28 languages. Scaling that kind of a thing isn't very easy, but with Puppet, it was made easier. As always, we like to keep the interests of the job seeker in mind, the best interests. So the format of this talk, I'm just going to be starting out talking about how Puppet reporting can reduce technical debt. I'll go over installing and configuring, very briefly, Elasticsearch, Logstash, and Kibana. I'll be using Puppet reports to troubleshoot failures, reveal bottlenecks in catalog application, and identify commits that may have broken Puppet. We'll be open sourcing all of the configuration and tools that you see throughout this talk. I did my best effort to put the link at the bottom of every slide that you'll see. So what I won't be covering in this talk, I won't be going over the architecture of Elasticsearch and Logstash as an entire talk on its own. I won't be going in depth in exploring the Elasticsearch query API. I'll just briefly touch on that. I won't really go over on how to scale Elasticsearch and Logstash. And I won't offer up any opinions on what the best Puppet report processor is. So this is a snapshot of our Puppet dashboard. As you can see, we've been tolerating this background radiation of failed catalog runs, and this has contributed to some of our technical debt. We've gotten by with this kind of a thing, but we would like to do better. We would like to start addressing this technical debt. Last year, Gene Kim gave a great talk where he mentioned that, it's a quote that I really like, when technical debt accrues, everybody loses. And it indeed, what we wanted to do was we wanted to shore up these failed catalog runs, and we wanted to see, you know, why is Puppet taking so long to run on some of our nodes? Very long Puppet runs is technical debt. So I'll go over how you can identify that in this talk. I won't really go over what's going on the server side, the catalog compilation side. Slowness there is just kind of rolls up into config retrieval time. Who here uses or has Puppet reporting turned on by a show of hands? Right. Wow, looks like about 30% of you. Who here has Puppet reporting turned off because you don't really know what to do with that data? Right. Not many of you. And then of the people that raise their hands and are doing Puppet reports, are you doing any kind of analysis or are you doing any kind of inspection on that data by a show of hands? So nobody, or a couple people. A couple people are even looking at the data that they're getting with Puppet reports. And then there's a wealth of data there. So I'll be talking about what change was introduced that broke Puppet, the slowest resources applying on each node, the resources that are causing the most issues, and nodes that haven't been enforcing the catalog in the longest time. Puppet report processors and integrations. There are a lot of them. You could tweet about every single one of your Puppet runs. You could generate a Jira ticket or a Zendesk ticket for any failures. You can put metrics in Datadog. You can have it go to a Slack or a HipChat channel. There are just so many of them. And even though they answer a lot of the same questions, sometimes the data that you have or the way that you've configured the data to ask your question might mean another tool is better than another. I'm just going to briefly talk about Puppet Enterprise. Out of the box, Puppet Enterprise already gives you analytics around your reporting. So if you're using Puppet Enterprise, you're already using Puppet reporting. All that data is stored in Puppet DB. And there's been kind of an evolution, starting with Puppet Dashboard and then the Event Inspector. And in recent versions of Puppet Enterprise, they've done a really good job of allowing you to kind of look at events, analyze resources that are failing. They'll be sorting on the most resources. But maybe you're like us. Maybe you haven't, you know, jumped on Puppet Enterprise yet. Maybe you're looking to do something else with the data. Maybe you want to supplement Puppet Enterprise. Something like this is very useful. This is also in Puppet Enterprise. It's the node graph. The node graph can help you quickly track down long chains of dependency failures. It allows you to analyze interactions between classes and defined types. And sometimes you could have a very deep chain of failures that are hard to track down. And that's another thing I like about Puppet Enterprise. But we're not here to talk about Puppet Enterprise. We're here to talk about Elasticsearch, Logstash, and Kibana. It is maintained by a company called Elastic. They kind of gathered up all of these great tools, and they've rebranded their company a bit, and they're doing some great things there. Let's start talking about Elasticsearch. Elasticsearch is an analytics platform built on top of a distributed search engine. And indeed, we use Elasticsearch before we started putting our reports in it. We use it to, we don't give our developers production access. So how do we expect them to deploy code on their own but not access production logs? Well, we tried to solve that problem with Elasticsearch by putting our logs into Elasticsearch and then allowing them to get those logs back out. I was talking to somebody at lunch today who, he works for a mining company, and he actually uses Elasticsearch to put all the sensor data inside the mine shafts into Elasticsearch, so you can do really, really great stuff with it. Logstash is a processing engine. It takes incoming logs and uses grok filters to create structured data from unstructured messages. In case of Puppet reporting, since the data is in JSON, Logstash doesn't have to do much. It's just a transport vehicle at that point. Kibana is the view layer of Elasticsearch. Kibana allows you to visualize data in Elasticsearch, create dashboards, and group your visualizations. Together, they make this application stack that is popularly referred to as the Elk Stack. And getting Puppet reports into Elasticsearch is straightforward, as I'll show you. It starts out with the agent requesting its configuration from the Puppet Master. But Puppet Master then compiles the catalog, and hopefully if all goes well, it sends that catalog to the agent, which applies it. During the catalog application, the agent is gathering a bunch of metrics, stats about the run, a bunch of logs, and if there are any failures, it'll also report on that. Once it finishes its run, if it's configured to do so, it'll send its run stats to the report server. The report server can be the same server as the Puppet Master, or if you want to scale, you can split it off into its own server that's distinct from the Puppet Master. The report server sends those stats and run logs to Logstash. Again, you can scale the Logstash server. We put ours behind an F5 load balancer and use TCP load balancing. Logstash server then sends that to the Elasticsearch cluster as JSON data. Elasticsearch cluster indexes that data. Installation is straightforward. I'm not going to go into the details of the installation, but you install Elasticsearch and Logstash on separate servers for scaling and best practices. Install the Puppet Logstash reporter. This was maintained in a different GitHub repository, but it's now been taken over by Elastic. We have a few pull requests that are outstanding. Right now, resource statuses aren't being sent to Elasticsearch, but we have a pull request that's going to allow those to be analyzed in Elasticsearch. So next, you configure the master and agent configuration. You set up the Logstash host and port. Install Kibana if you want to create visualizations. We put ours behind a proxying web server because we want an authentication layer and we want to terminate SSL. Once you have this all set up and you've got your stack going, your job isn't done. You want to periodically perform maintenance tasks, maybe automate them. I recommend if you retire some servers, retire nodes, whether you do this as an automated task or something manual, you want to get these out of Elasticsearch because it ends up just being cruft, and the information you get out of it, such as unresponsive nodes, might be spurious. What we do is we have an index for each day's worth of runs, and we just kind of expire the tail of that. But you could also set a TTL on your documents, which causes them to be discarded after a certain period of time. You want to make sure you're keeping everything up to date, keeping on top of patches and upgrades for Elasticsearch, Logstash, Kibana, Puppet. You also want to monitor an alert on the uptime of this infrastructure. You want to know if it goes down. You want to avoid any gaps that may be caused by infrastructure that's not up. Also, be mindful of report format changes. We're on version 4 of the report, and they're already marking some of the fields for deprecation because they're redundant or unnecessary. So don't be worried if you can't really read what's in a Puppet report. I'll be calling out some of the more interesting details, but it exposes things like the time and seconds that it took to apply certain resources. Rolls up any information about the events, failures, no ops, things that are out of sync. It also aggregates all of the individual resources and the time it took to apply. As you can see here, something that immediately might come as a surprise is how long it's taking to apply the package resource, nearly 400 seconds. So that's something that could immediately catch your attention and allow you to drill down and figure out what's going on. Of special importance, I want to outline the config version. This is something that, if you're not doing it today, I recommend that you're tying into your revision control system like Git. By default, out of the box, I think Puppet will use like Unix epoch time to uniquely identify catalogs. But I really recommend tying it in with your environment and the revision. It's useful because you could troubleshoot failures and verify changes. You could test for item potence by comparing config versions. We're going to be open sourcing some tools. PuppetShow.py is a Python script that we wrote to answer many questions about Puppet runs and by querying Elasticsearch. Puppet disauth, which stands for did I succeed or fail. That script allows you to pass a list of nodes on standard in and get back the last run status, whether it succeeded or failed. Puppet blame is a tool for identifying commits that broke Puppet. Puppet show can answer certain questions that we've had in Indeed, like which nodes are unresponsive. This just means that for whatever time period or interval that you deem important, if you're doing your Puppet runs every hour, say, an appropriate unresponsive interval would be maybe an hour and a half. If you haven't seen reports, then it's unresponsive. Catalog compilation failures, those are very important because that means the entire catalog is out of compliance. Idempotence violations, nodes that have been failing the longest, nodes with the most failures, and resources that are responsible for the most failures. So why might a node stop submitting its reports? Well, maybe the Puppet daemon isn't running and it's not generating any Puppet runs. Maybe there's a stale lock file or PID file. Maybe the master is simply just not sending its report. It's not configured to or can't because of some sort of issue. Catalog hasn't compiled in a long time. Maybe that's breaking on the server side. Perhaps there's a misconfiguration. Or what I've seen, the Linux OOM killer, if there's a lot of memory pressure on a system, it'll just start reaping Puppet runs every time it goes off. Let's start out with a query. We're going to look for unresponsive nodes. So first, we do a unique host aggregation. It allows us to get all of the unique host names back. The second query we do is for each of those nodes, based on a threshold that we expect the report to be submitted in, we then query for that unique hostname or FQDN. In the last 60 minutes, have you seen a document? Unresponsive nodes is simply the set from the first query less the second set. This gives us nodes that are we have documents for, but no recent runs. And this is easily done in Puppet Show. You just pass the unresponsive flag, give it a time in minutes, and the output will tell you which nodes haven't succeeded or haven't submitted a report and when the last report was seen. Catalog compilation, as I mentioned, is a big problem. If it didn't compile, how do we know that from the viewpoint of analysis in Elasticsearch? This string could not retrieve catalog from a remote server. If we see that, we know there's been a failure. So let's do an algorithm here. Let's perform a query aggregation for unique hosts, as I showed earlier. Let's iterate over those hosts, retrieving the newest document per host. Let's check the catalog run status, see if it's a failure. If it's a failure, we can look in the logs field for the string could not retrieve catalog. Then we grab the index. We populate the associative array where the key is the hash of the failure signature. So let's say that the failure says cannot retrieve catalog because there's a variable that can't be interpolated. That's the signature. So let's look at this in action. We pass the catalog failure flag. And what we've done here is we've rolled up all of these hosts that have the same reason that the catalog can't compile. So in this case, these three nodes can't compile their catalog because of this issue with LV size. We can also use Puppet Show for checking idempotence. Why is idempotence important? Running Puppet twice against the same catalog should yield the same result. If it doesn't, the guarantees that Puppet has about compliance is violated. All bets are off. So this is a state transition diagram. We start on catalog V1 in blue, and in orange, we transition to catalog V2. Once we're on catalog V2, consecutive Puppet runs with the same catalog version should follow these states. Green means good, red means bad. If you're going from an unchanged run and all of a sudden changes are happening with the same catalog, that's bad. If you have a run that makes some changes and then makes some changes again and then makes some changes again, that's also bad. Just a different view in kind of a matrix. So let's look at the algorithm. Perform a query aggregation like we've seen before for our unique hosts. Query the host for the configuration version and status. Group documents by identical config version. Then pairwise compare them, the catalog status transitions going forward in time. So config version V2, config version V2, what does the status look like for that node? And this would be, you know, an example of what the query might look like. We just care about these two fields, configuration, version, and status, and we're matching on a certain node. And we sort by time. So let's get to the visualization portion. Interrogating Puppet runs with Kibana. So how many of you here have used Kibana before? And how many of you liked version 1, 2, or even 3? Yeah. Version 4 is better. If you haven't used it, I promise they've made great improvements. You can do a time filter based on a whole bunch of things, years, previous year, week, day. You can update your dashboards dynamically by just choosing different time intervals. So first, we're going to profile our Puppet performance with Kibana. Let's start with something simple. How many resources has changed, failed, or been skipped, or been out of sync? We just do a unique count aggregation on resource statuses.title. Resource statuses is the pull request that we're making to Puppet Logstash Reporter that's going to allow that to be indexed. So that's not available today in Puppet Logstash Reporter, but if my merge request is accepted, then it will be. So in the past week, 6,095 distinct resources have been out of sync. In and of itself, that might be not a very significant piece of information, but let's look at something more interesting. What are our nodes doing? What are they spending the most time doing? Well, with Puppet Show, maybe you can get information of the Puppet Show script. You can figure out what some of the more heavier resources that apply. Maybe it's firewall, maybe it's the package resource. And then we can take metrics on that and look at that over a time scale. Unfortunately, the legend, I don't know how to change the legend to make it clear what these are, but you know, purple is the config retrieval time. That's the server side time to compile and send the catalog. There's package in there, service. And this helps you break down over your entire infrastructure what some of your heaviest your heaviest resources are. And maybe by looking at why, maybe yum is configured in a weird way, or maybe you're pointing at a slow yum repository. Maybe that can help identify where you can shore up some of your application times. You can also look at how many resources that have been out, or you can look at which nodes have had the most resources out of compliance. So of all the nodes, which one consistently just can't seem to stay in compliance? So we do a unique count of resource statuses, and it looks like this. Over the past week, and I've blocked out the host names, but over the past week, these hosts have consistently had resources that are out of compliance. This could indicate perhaps idempotency violation or idempotence violation. This could indicate that it was a brand new server that week and it just had a lot of resources to apply. Or it can indicate that there's just a lot of problems with that server. You can also look at which nodes are taking the longest time to apply the catalog. I chose the 50th percentile for the runtime because if you do a 90th percentile or a 99th percentile, then you're going to get maybe a host that was brought up that week or that day, and it's going to completely skew the data. But by looking at the 50th percentile, you can really identify which nodes are consistently being slow. So we have several nodes here that take a really, really long time to run, to apply the catalog. And this isn't even the entire run. Putting it all together, you can put it on a dashboard. I added a few things on this dashboard that you didn't see. Unique count of hosts, that's 1389. That was the unique count of hosts in the last 24 hours. 1552 is the unique count of hosts that of all the documents it's seen. So this could indicate, this disparity could indicate that you have unresponsive nodes or decommissioned nodes that are just hanging around as cruft. Did Puppet succeed or fail? Puppet, did I succeed or fail, is a Python script we wrote. And we use a lot of Linux pipelines. So it was more natural for us to pass the hosts in as newline separated list on standard in. It might look a little funky, but this allows us for really long pipelines. And by piping these host names to the Python script, it can tell you not only which hosts failed, but it can quickly summarize those logs, so you don't have to go open up a dashboard or log onto the server. It'll be right there in your terminal. You could also summarize, I just want the names of the hosts that are failing and when they last, or when they failed, or if they succeeded. Maybe if you're getting ready to put dependencies in place for a deployment, just running this across your whatever role you care about can allow you to verify if Puppet made all of the hosts that the software is going to be deployed to in compliance. By a show of hands, who here uses mCollective? Okay, so about 40% of you. If you don't know what mCollective is, it's a very useful server orchestration framework. Using a PubSub infrastructure with queuing like ActiveMQ or RabbitMQ, you can broadcast a request to all of the servers that say something like, if you have this type of service running, report in. If you have this sort of fact, report in and let me know. You can use it with Elasticsearch together to identify or ask some questions in a very specific way. It helps us build and refine these queries. So let's have a story here. Say that there's an upgrade to an NRPE script that checks RAID volumes. It was available, you applied it everywhere. But that upgrade didn't go very well at all. The NRPE script that at one time was reporting healthy RAID array no longer succeeds. But we have a patch, and we can use Puppet to push out that patch, hopefully very quickly. An hour later, pagers are still going off. You're getting complaints that your upgrade broke everything and your patch still didn't work on all the nodes. Puppet, you had one job. So let's combine mCollective and did I succeed or fail to figure out why this change didn't, or this patch didn't apply everywhere. mCollective has an NRPE plugin. This means that you can actually do an NRPE query across your infrastructure and get back only the nodes that fail that NRPE command. We start out by using the NRPE plugin with the has RAID true fact. This could be any fact that you have that might indicate that there's a RAID volume, it's not a VM. And then you run the check RAID NRPE command. You kind of put the data in a format that's friendly to did I succeed or fail, new line separated, host names. And then a feature of did I succeed or fail that resource statuses in Elasticsearch allows us to have is did check RAID succeed or fail. This allows us to report back if check RAID, managing check RAID, was successful or a failure. We see that it was successful on SFO prod 1, but on September 18th was the last Puppet run. And we pushed out our patch on September 20th. So that's an unresponsive node. The next three nodes, where check RAID isn't in compliance, those failed. So we can go and attack those individual nodes, and maybe there's some low-hanging fruit. You can fix the problem, and then take care of all three nodes at the same time. And then go on SFO prod 1 and figure out why Puppet's not running. What's really frustrating for me is when I go onto a server to do a manual Puppet run, and I see this in my terminal. That's really annoying. So I want to track down as quickly as possible the cause of this brokenness. With puppetblame.py, you can do that hopefully automatically. It uses git bisect in the background, which means it requires that you use git for your Puppet infrastructure. It requires setting a configuration version so you know, so you can tag each catalog with a git SHA. And it requires the ability to compile the catalog wherever you run the script, so on your Puppet master with facts cached. So let's pass the list of nodes in on standard in. Sorry, let's take a brief diversion here and talk about how git bisect works. Git bisect works on the concept of the binary search algorithm. We have two unknowns, we're looking for a known. We know the last known good version. We know a node that is definitely bad. And we want to know which node introduced the regression. So in a binary search algorithm, you start out, you take the difference, you cut the difference right in half, you start out right in the middle, and you check, is the regression in revision 160? Nope, we're good. Take the difference between 160 and 164. Is the regression there? Yep. And then finally, the difference between 162 and 160, 161 has a regression. That is the revision that broke Puppet. So right now, you run Puppet blame interactively if it's an application failure. So you pipe on standard in, one node or multiple nodes, and it'll iteratively run this interactively per node. It'll report back the oldest success it found in Elasticsearch and the first failure. It does this, it's able to find these SHAs because it can query Elasticsearch for the first or the last time that node was successful and then get its SHA. Then it can look at the first time and there was a failure, get that SHA. At this point, it'll prompt the user to go perform a dry run on a node and report back whether it was successful or had a problem. A couple iterations of this, and you'll find out it'll report back what the change was that broke Puppet. You might notice that the more often you're enforcing your catalog, the less steps this will take, the better your chances are of discovering what broke Puppet. So what happens if the catalog failed to compile? Then we don't really get back the version of the catalog it tried to enforce. But we're OK. In fact, we don't even need to interactively interact with the script at all. We still can know the last good revision. That's still in Elasticsearch. And then we could just do a git log from before the timestamp of the failure, get back one SHA, and use that as our bad revision. We want an early bad revision. Then git bisect has a subcommand called run. If you pass it a shell script, it'll run that shell script iteratively. If it returns or exits zero, then it'll mark that commit as good. If it exits 1 through 27, any of those exit codes, it'll mark it as bad. Let's look at it in action. Node1.devserver can't compile its catalog. We pass it on standard in to Puppet blame. We get back the oldest success and the first failure. Then it says it has 7 revisions left to test. That's 3 steps. And it runs this Puppet compile shell script, which I'll show you in a bit, automatically. It'll check out the right revision and run the shell script, which will compile Puppet, use cached facts on your master. A couple more iterations of this. You just sit back and watch it happen. And finally, it arrives at the bad commit. The shell script, puppetcompile.sh, just one line. There are some flags I omitted that if you're using the default values for, like your config directory, then you don't need to touch those. If you're doing it out of your own environment or a dynamic environment, you can pass that as an environmental variable through Puppet blame. Today you saw that we reduced our technical debt by locating nodes that aren't submitting reports, surfacing nodes that are failing catalog compilation, ensuring Puppet runs aren't violating idempotents, and identifying why agents are taking a long time to apply the catalog. And then finally, we looked at tracking down commits that broke Puppet. We're not done. We have a lot of work to do, and we want to share that work with you. We want to make Puppet blame more automatic. Maybe if it's an application failure, you can use the mCollective Puppet plugin to go and put a message on the queue that that agent, that that node consumes and does a dry run for you, reports into Elasticsearch, and you block for a little while until that report gets into Elasticsearch, and Puppet blame can then mark automatically success or fail. Maybe Beaker can help. Maybe we could do some acceptance testing in production-like servers. I also want to add more use cases to Puppet Show. Maybe look at this quasi-state where the catalog compiles, gets sent to the agent, but the agent can't apply the entire catalog, which is just as bad as a catalog compilation. And then we are looking at using Puppet reporting for patch management and compliance. I opened the talk with a quote from Gene Kinn that said, "Technical debt, when technical debt accrues, that everybody loses." If we take that as a truism, then it follows that if we work as an organization to pare down our technical debt and reduce it, then we become winners. And I hope that today I showed you how to become winners by using Puppet reporting with Elasticsearch, Logstash, and Kibana. Thank you. So we have time for any questions you might have. State your name with your questions so that I can repeat it back. Yes.
Hi, my name is Vadim Chipkov. I don't have a question, so I just have several comments for you.
Sure.
First of all, that technique that you showed us pretty much is not applicable in any serious environment because you imply that your Git repository is monolithic, right? So, realistically speaking, most of us will have a failure like introduced in some modules that we include in some Puppet file, right? So we cannot use that technique to find out. And on top of that, Puppet Master has been removed from the Puppet Enterprise in version 3.7, so you cannot use it in the compile script as well. So just an observation.
Yeah, for those of you who didn't hear, the observation was that not everyone runs or compiles their catalog the same way. Not everyone runs their Puppet Masters the same way. Some people don't even use a Puppet Master. And so that necessarily won't be the right technique for you to figure out what broke Puppet. But hopefully it gave you, you know, an idea about how you can do something similar to track down problems that were introduced by a commit.
Hi, my name is Spencer Crum. I work at IBM. I was wondering, before you started on this journey, what did you have in place for Puppet reporting? Like some people use the Enterprise Console or Puppet Board or whatever. And I'm interested to know where you started that, and then you ended. I know where you ended up, but I'd like to know where you started.
Yeah, so we started out with nothing. We were only keeping logs of the reports on our master. We weren't really doing much with it. And in, I think, 2011, 2012, we spun up the Puppet dashboard. We spun up Foreman. We looked at the features, and we knew we needed something that allowed us to quickly figure out whether or not we were compliant everywhere. And the Puppet dashboard had some nice features, but over the years, we found that there were limitations. We found ourselves actually writing similar Python scripts that was treating the Puppet dashboard DB as Elasticsearch. We had an early version of the dashboard. We ran into some pain points. Like in the early schema, the resource statuses table had int as the ID. And so we quickly ran into max int issues with that. We had to change our schema. The database got very large over time, and optimizations became a pain point for our DBAs. So that's why we find ourselves here looking at something like Elk. Yes.
Uh, Hi, I'm Ramin. I work at Twitter. If you have multiple DCs, or do you have a like a single Logstash or Elasticsearch you're pumping into, or do you have multiple, based on which DC or however you might be splitting it out?
The question is, do we have multi-DC Elasticsearch, or how do we scale our Elasticsearch? We have a cluster based in our Austin data center that if we need to scale that, we could just add nodes. And then we're also going to put that in a kind of a disaster recovery scenario in a different data center. We could definitely scale our cluster out to other data centers, and we've thought about doing that. All right. Oh, we have a question over there.
In the dashboard, you got a way to filter on the fact that by operating system.
In the dashboard? The question was, can you filter by operating system or fact in the dashboard? I don't think that you can. The dashboard's been open sourced, but there's not a lot of activity on it. So I don't think there's a way that, you, like, in enterprise, you might be able to do, you are able to do that, but not, I don't think, in the dashboard.
In your dashboard,
in Elasticsearch. Yes. What you could do actually is you can use mCollective, as you saw, to query based on a fact and then pass that in to a script that queries Elasticsearch. But we don't put any of the facts in the dash in Elasticsearch. All right. Well, that's all the questions. I'd like to thank everyone for coming. I'd like you to leave feedback on my Twitter or in the Slack channel, or you could just contact me, find me after the talk, or send me an email. All right, thank you.
Thanks, Alex.